The Shenandoah Valley is one of the most picturesque sites in the United States and one of the most historical. Cut through the rich bottomland of Virginia by the River Shenandoah, the valley is framed by the Massanutten Mountains and the Blue Ridge. As the seasons change, the foliage becomes a breathtaking kaleidoscope of color. The beauty of the valley made it a natural place for towns and villages to grow. The lush land provided a bounty of agricultural products. The terrain made the area a convenient gateway between the north and the south. In the late 1700s, the valley was surveyed and forts were built to protect settlers from the Indians. As the Indians were displaced west, settlers from England, Scotland, Germany, and Ireland flooded the area. The influx of permanent residents was facilitated by several improvements in transportation. Ferries were built to traverse the many rivers and creeks. And by the mid-1800s, some rivers in the valley were made navigable by systems of locks and dams. One of the biggest undertakings was the creation of a hard-surface turnpike that stretched from Winchester, Virginia, to Harrisonburg, and ultimately to Stanton. Completed by 1840, the paved road was 18 feet wide and 12 inches thick. With the ease of transportation and the abundance of natural resources, the Shenandoah Valley quickly became the breadbasket of the South. Southern society reveled in the beauty and abundance. Many diaries from the period still exist to tell the story of the time. The diaries of sisters Molly and Victoria Hansford give insight into the world of the valley.
The house was built with a large square frame timbers filled in with brick, making it very strong. It had a long porch running the full length of the house. There was a wide hall running between the main house with Venetian shutters at the end instead of doors. They almost carried me in the house. And then they soon had supper on the table. Fried chicken, batter cakes, and the nicest honey and all kinds of other good things.
The peaceful existence of the Hansford sisters came to an end as the rumbling of the Civil War echoed through the valley. Poised so close to the nation's capital, Winchester became a pawn that would change hands over 72 times during the Civil War. What had once been a city standing as a sentinel guarding the South's most critical resources was now the gateway for federal armies into the Shenandoah Valley. By 1864, nothing was sacred.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Molly Hansford writes,
"A Yank came to my door with a ham, and I asked him where he got it. Out of your meat house. It was the last piece. I told him I would go to his captain and get a stop put to this stealing. Go ahead, he said. He's the one who told us to help ourselves. They cut all the fruit-bearing trees. They ruined our gardens. What they were not able to take, they destroyed. There never was an army in the world as well provisioned as the Federal Army. At the same time, our men were literally starving."
I first came here with my Willem, got married in apple blossom time. My, this whole valley was just covered with beautiful white snowy blossoms. We had a farm, Willem and I. Had about 60 acres under plow.
As Sheridan pulled back in a leisurely manner to the area of Hupp's Hill and just to the north around Belgrove Plantation between the later part of September and about the 10th of October, virtually every usable economic asset in the region was destroyed. This is known locally as the burning with a capital B. This was done largely, of course, by the cavalry because they had the mobility to go place to place. Things that were damaged would be such things as barns, mills, warehouses, any public buildings, and any public property. Herds of livestock would either be carried away or destroyed. Grain storage would be again either destroyed or sequestered, confiscated, whatever you want to say, for the federal use. It was pretty hard. The orders to the soldiers were not to destroy private residences, and they were generally upheld. The destruction was reasonably disciplined. But people say that you could look from one side of the valley to the other, and it would be just one great pall of smoke from east to west as the Federals pulled into their final camps. From a soldier's viewpoint, this was almost a picnic, but it was certainly not for those who had to live through it. Like most families in the area, they were left destitute with no recovery in sight. Many cunning attacks against the Union troops were led by a local soldier, John S. Mosby. Mosby repeatedly attacked the Union forces, which often retaliated against the people in the valley. A Yankee officer once suggested to Molly Hansford that they petition Jeff Davis to withdraw Mosby from the valley. Molly wrote,
"I told him never. We would rather suffer.
We have no food and no protection. That's the really hard part. With the men away, who's to protect us? So a lot of us have packed up what we have left of our homes and have fled with our boys in gray. We kind of follow the camps. We do laundry, mend, tend the wounded, cook. It's not much to cook. We scavenge and glean from the fields. We've had to revive a lot of the old arts. We do spinning, weaving. Had to make do with a lot of things. In fact, we've learned how to make baking soda from the ashes of corn cobs. Just a lot of things that are really hard. Children find it very, very hard to survive here now. They die so young, what with sleeping out in the open and the sickness and the poor diet. It's really hard for them. A lot of the boys, when they get to be about 14, run off and try to join the armies. It's getting to be a real, real hard life for us here.
No medicine, no doctors. And this one, all he wants to talk about is joining the army.
I want to fight.
See what I mean? Will there ever be peace?
We've had nearly 4 years of war, 4 years of devastation.
The destruction of the valley, though severe, was part of a larger plan to stop the Confederacy. The battles began with Jackson's campaign of 1862. Kernstown in March, Front Royal, the First Winchester in May and June 1862. Later, the Second Battle of Winchester in June 1863. Then Newmarket, Piedmont, and Second Kernstown in May, June, and July of 1864. Third Battle of Winchester, Fisher's Hill, and Cedar Creek in the fall of 1864. Both sides were confident of victory. The Union forces often were better armed and equipped. The men who fought for the Confederacy did so with fewer resources. Their devotion more than compensated. In 1 6-week period in 1862, Stonewall Jackson marched his troops 600 miles. Jackson's death in 1863 at Chancellorsville caused a serious blow to the morale of the South. No Southern leader after him proved capable of saving the valley. With the election of 1864 approaching, President Abraham Lincoln desired to put a decisive end to this divisive war. He supported his new general-in-chief, Ulysses S. Grant, in the execution of a continental-wide plan. Grant saw the economic destruction of the valley as contributing to this victory plan. Destruction of the valley became part of the Federal soldiers' mission. General Philip Sheridan had been given command of Federal forces in the valley in August of 1864. General Grant ordered him to, quote, follow Jubal Early to the death and to strip the valley so thoroughly that crows flying over it would have to carry their own provender, end quote. While Sheridan received orders at his headquarters near Harper's Ferry, Jubal Early prepared to save the valley. After defeats at Winchester and Fisher's Hill in September, Early planned on a 19 October nighttime attack on Belgrove Plantation, headquarters of the Union Army. This attack was part of the decisive Battle of Cedar Creek. Both governments tried their very best to give their men all that was needed to prosecute the war. This meant, of course, in the northern side, that generally speaking, there would be adequate food and adequate armaments and clothing. On the Confederate side, Every effort was made, of course, to get men firearms, and generally I'd say that was done. But the other aspects of survival were pretty much left up to the initiative of the men themselves. You have such graphic examples of huge numbers of stragglers during Lee's Antietam campaign because the men did not have any shoes and most of the roads in Maryland were hard surfaced. In other cases, in part of the valley operations, the only food the Confederates had would be early ripening fruits and corn standing in the fields just because the system of their creaking logistics couldn't keep up with them. This, of course, happened to Federals periodically, but never at the same scale and never as consistently. In field conditions, Confederates again were pretty much on their own. Northerners developed not only the elaborate sort of headquarters and hospital tents, but also soldiers were issued what persons with military experience today would know as a shelter half. These would go together to make a pup tent, which, by the way, is a Civil War nickname for this little shelter for two people.
We are right now encamped around Cedar Creek and the Belgrove Plantation. We do not plan the winter in this location, but we are holding in this location until further ordered. General Sheridan has been ordered to Washington to a council of war. We expect his return at any time. The Army is now under the control of General Horatio G. Wright, the commander of the 6th Corps, and we await any further orders. We are basically to hold in camp at this time. The enemy doesn't appear to be threatening, but we do have our pickets out and our scouts out, and we are running reconnaissance. So at this time, things are fairly quiet within the federal camp, and we don't expect any trouble out of that camp. Rumor is about that Early may mount another attack on us, but it has yet to be seen, and if such attack would be mounted, it should be small and wouldn't be anything unexpected that we'd know about.
This large map board here represents the area that the Battle of Cedar Creek took place on. The Federals had pulled back into this general area around Belgrove by the 11th and 12th of October 1864. They really set up almost in a camp-like atmosphere. Absolutely beautiful autumn weather, assuming that Early was no longer a threat. And they used the stream of Cedar Creek itself as the base for their defense. And you can see that there might be a difficulty. It's pretty strong if someone were to come at them across the stream. However, they seem to be relying on the rather rough terrain on the east as part of their defense. General Early brought his people up to Fisher's Hill, which is about 2 miles south of Strasburg. And then every day thereafter, he probed the federal lines, trying to find a way to get into these federal camps to inflict a defeat on them. Obviously, in seeing the primary setup and where these little sticks are glued to the surface represent trenches, some of the positions were enormously strong. Even here, they were digging in, although they seemed to be awfully far from any real support. So going up the middle was no solution. He probed to the west, and you can see over there where the federal cavalry is deployed, and you may recognize the name Custer. That's George Armstrong Custer of Little Bighorn fame. So he is involved here. Another cavalry officer of some note is Wesley Merritt, who later in life was the conqueror of Manila in the War with Spain. In the 8th Corps area, there seemed to be the greatest chance of getting in. It's kind of interesting with the 8th Corps. You'll notice the name Hayes here. This is the division commander, is Rutherford B. Hayes, who became president in 1877. And his supply officer, or one of his supply officers, was Captain William McKinley. And McKinley, of course, became president in 1896 and was the commander-in-chief of Merritt during the war. The other infantry division, under General Gabriel Wharton, with General Early going with him, would move to Hupp's Hill and then would come forward along the pike to be in a position to help when it was possible to get up on the other side of the creek. You can see off in the distance the cavalry, Rosser's division, were told to cross on the western fords of Cedar Creek and to try to get up behind the Federals to cut off their retreat. The battle area, just if you're thinking of it, if you redo just the infantry part, is perhaps 16 by 10 miles, and if you include the cavalry, it's more like 25 by 30, so it's really an enormous region. Well, it went off as planned. The Confederates were blessed with a moonlit night to allow them to get into position, and then a heavy fog came up, which is very common in this area in the fall, and Kershaw's people contacted the Federals, commanded by Colonel Joseph Thoburn. Thoburn himself was mortally wounded, and that was, of course, the signal for Gordon's improvised corps to smash into the rest of Crook's force. These men were overwhelmed very early. Some units held together, but most of them, caught by surprise, still in their tents, making breakfast, that sort of thing, were forced rapidly back. They bought a few minutes, and that allowed the 19th Corps, stationed in the center, to begin to move from its very heavily entrenched positions to try to form a line to confront the Confederates more or less along the pike. The problem was they couldn't get fellows over fast enough to form a coherent line, and so as unit after unit was committed, it did serve the purpose of being a tripwire to the Confederate advance, sometimes slowing it down a little bit or at least imperceptibly damaging it, so the cumulative effect was going to be quite serious, but not enough to stop the Confederates from sweeping over the old Federal camps. There was a sharp struggle in the vicinity of Belle Grove as the headquarters people got all their materiel away. One division, Kershaw's, which had been following Cedar Creek, was stopped, and you can see how the creek flows in a little bow there, and it was actually trying to cross to get back into the fight, getting into Gordon's way. General Wharton's division was moving along the road, trying to get into a line somewhere it could be helpful, and Ramseur's and Pegram's division were also getting into a rather confusing mill around in this area. The Confederate pressure was still sufficient, however, to force two of the divisions of the 6th Corps out of the way. The final division, which was just trying to get into the line, realizing it was being left high and dry, pulled back to a rather strong position in the vicinity of the Middletown Town Cemetery, which you see here, this little square. The three brigades of this division set up in something like a fish hook, and the Confederates tried to attack it four times. By that time, the Confederate artillery had pulled up to an area just south of Middletown, and it too began to fire on the Federals. It was at this point that most people would say that General Early lost his vision of the battlefield and became too focused on getting this one division off the cemetery hill. As a result, a considerable drift and adjustment of lines occurred amongst the Confederates. They lost the momentum of their attack. Also, as they came to a halt, and if the men were not participating in the battle, Early at least alleges that many of them went back into the captured camps to loot and just get something to eat. It had been a long time since they'd had anything to eat. When the Federal commander of this one division, the 2nd Division 6th Corps, realized that all of his comrades had gotten away, he decided there were no odds in remaining in that position, so he too withdrew, pulling back to a position just to the north of Middletown, and ultimately joining a line being formed by General Wright about 2 miles north of Middletown. At about 10:30 in the morning, as this was being done, General Sheridan returned to the field. He'd been in Winchester the night before and didn't realize anything was happening until he's actually coming down the next morning and encountered stragglers. Sheridan galvanized new life into his men. General Wright had them in hand, but nobody was being particularly aggressive. And he just saw this as an opportunity to finish Early off once and for all, if he could contrive the correct situation. Early's people, in the meanwhile, had gone up on the cemetery hill and then had moved forward to positions just north of Middletown in a configuration running roughly along this road, which is known as Height Chapel Road. Three of his generals were extremely upset that he had stopped and pressured him to allow them to move forward. And he finally relented. And at about noon, he allowed his three western divisions to go another perhaps half a mile northward. So he'd really created a very awkward position for himself. He had them running this way and then swinging back in kind of a reverse hook through Middletown, which meant that there are several points of vulnerability. Sheridan, in the meantime, directed the cavalry division of Merritt, which had moved over to this area where the modern school campus is, to continue to pressure the Federals in the Middletown area. Custer, who had come over with Merritt and was in a position about half a mile north of him, was directed at about 1 o'clock in the afternoon to go all the way west again, as far out as he could, and cause the Confederates to keep extending their lines to try to prevent him from getting through them. I call this kind of the rubber band effect. It was Sheridan's hope to be justified that ultimately Gordon, who was on the extreme west, would stretch so far that a gap would appear. His line would start to break. And this raises the whole question or issue of how do these people fight these battles? The soldiers by this time have become very much aware of the devastation of the technology of their time. Firearms and artillery were indeed much more lethal. But you still had to move men in organized bodies, much the way you would a drill team in high school or college, because the only way they could still be effective would be to deliver their volleys more or less in unison. So the men moved in more open order, but they still had to maintain physical links. They'd be able to almost reach out and touch the fellows on either side of them so that their line could not be penetrated. The same way holds for larger units, such as brigades and regiments. They had to be linked. You saw down around Belle Grove, even being visually linked was not enough. There had to be some semblance of physical contact so there'd be no holes in your line. Well, what happened to Gordon was that one brigade, realizing it was being stretched too far, tried to adjust, and a gap indeed appeared. General Custer, who was an extremely aggressive commander, saw his opportunity and, disregarding any fear for flanks or rear, just went for the Confederate rear. At that point, Gordon said panic set into his people. It was almost like an infection or a contagion or someone shaking a carpet and having that ripple go all the way the length of it. And brigade after brigade began to pull apart. And as they did, the neighboring divisions also began to panic. Dodson Ramseur, at a place called Miller's Mill, was able to offer some resistance with his men and some men from Kershaw's division, his neighbor, until he was mortally wounded. He was evacuated initially in ambulance, and I'll tell you a little more about him in a minute. But with Ramseur's injury, most coherent Confederate resistance was broken. The Federal cavalry on this side began to press forward, and the infantry, which had been held in line and had brought pressure on the Confederates in this counterattack, then gathered momentum and swept all before them. The Confederates resisted briefly in the vicinity of the old 19th Corps positions, and again in a few places south of Cedar Creek, particularly at Hupp's Hill, but by that time there was no point, and they were all getting away to save themselves. A small bridge on the west side of Strasburg broke, and as a result, all of the rolling stock that General Early had captured or had brought north of the little no-name stream that was there was captured by the rampaging Yankee cavalry, including about 1,600 prisoners. That materiel was brought back first to Stickley's Hill, and then ultimately it was retrograded to the vicinity of Belle Grove. In the course of this, the ambulance containing the mortally wounded Dodson Ramseur was captured, and Ramseur, a classmate of many of the Federal officers from West Point, was brought to Belle Grove and placed in the library where he was given medical care until he died. His old friend from West Point, Wesley Merritt, was with him at the time he died. He had been visited a few hours earlier by George Custer. With the capture of the Confederate trains, this in essence ends the Battle of Cedar Creek.
This is General Kiefer of the Federals. Dead and dying men were found in the darkness almost everywhere. Cries of agony from suffering victims were heard in all directions, and the moans of wounded animals added much to the horrors of the night. Mercy abandons the arena of battle, but when the conflict is ended, mercy again asserts itself. The disabled of both armies were cared for alike, far into the night, with some all the long night. The heroes of the day's strife ministered to friends and foe alike, where but the night before our army had peacefully slumbered, little dreaming of the death struggle of the coming day.
The Confederate loss at Cedar Creek would be a final blow to the Confederates in the Shenandoah Valley. The resources of the valley were nearly destroyed, and the morale of the Confederacy was undermined. The Union was triumphant. The next spring, Confederate General Robert E. Lee said, quote,
"I would rather die 1,000 deaths than surrender."
But with fewer and fewer rebel troops facing the growing Union masses, Lee had no choice. On Palm Sunday, April 9, 1865, Lee surrendered the Army of Northern Virginia at Appomattox. Over 3,500 men had died in the Battle of Cedar Creek. In total, the Civil War claimed over 2.5 million lives, more than all the U.S. wars combined. It would be a full 100 years before the burned-out valley was restored economically to its share of the gross national product. When the fighting ended, the restoration of families and the country began. The proud heritage of both sides of the conflict has been preserved in the valley, a valley that remains lush and abundant, united once more under a single flag.
Thank you.